Okay. Myself, Roshan Bhattarai. And today I am going to talk about how we can diagnose the WordPress attack. It's about the attack which happens from my server and to my server. From my server and to my server. Okay? How many of you are using unmanaged server? Which you manage yourself? Anyone? Okay, 1, 2, 3, great. Okay, so other people don't want to manage it. Okay, no problem. Maybe in future you may have to manage it. Then it might come handy at the time. Okay? Okay, about me. CTO at co-founder and CTO at Proshore. Also co-author of Starting and Explore Street. And I'm also co-author of PhD at Proshore. Okay, disclaimer. First, I want to make a fairly clear disclaimer. This server was the same as 64-bit server. And this technique, which I used to diagnose, was a my personal choice. It might not be the best choice. It might not be the best thing ever. So that's what I want to clarify to all of you. Okay, so there might be better technique. There might be something which you can explore. But this can be a starting point for you if you encounter this kind of problem in the future. Okay, what is it about? What kind of problem I have faced? This is a very common problem, I think, many people are facing. They spam email sent from a script and it causes the CPU overhead. If you are using the shared hosting, then yeah, you might get an email. Okay, your WordPress site is sending spam email, so now we'll disable your site or block the site. Anybody face that? Okay, there is already one. And there is another one, which is very interesting. Brute force attack, and that was happening from my server. Somebody is facing like, okay, your WP login is getting brute force attack from adding username and other password. Anybody face that? Okay, there is one. Yeah, that's a pretty common problem. And that happens when your server is totally attacked by a spammer, get a control of it, upload a file, and that does the brute force attack. And this attack happens when the other party say, okay, your IP is sending brute force attack from our server, do something, right? Then there's a good chance that your IP of the server might get blacklisted in many instances. Okay, so I'll tell you how AI diagnoses this kind of problem. But there is a disclaimer that this was an unmanaged server and I had the access of SSL. So if you don't have access of SSL, then I might have to say sorry to you guys. Okay, I think everybody try this first. WP Exploit Scanner. It's a very handy plugin. If your WordPress site is getting controlled by the spammer, then yeah. This to export the scanner and security. This plugin, you just install it, try to scan your site. Then yeah, if you are lucky, then it might be able to help you. And most of the time it does. Okay? But in my case, yeah, I don't know. The server did not allow to the memory did not allow to run this plugin and it was just overloading at the middle. And yeah. That was the case, so these two problems did not come handy. And the other problem was there was a binary file. And the binary file, these two problems find hard to identify. So, yeah, that was the two problems. So, these two problems did not help me at all. So, I have to go for an alternative way. Okay, what's the alternative way? Command line is your friend, it's very handy. If you get knowledge of the command line, if you use the server, if you use the managed server, or if you have the SSH, try knowing some command, do not harm you. Okay, CPU overload. Now I want to show you how we have diagnosis. There is a top command. There is a top command in in a Unix-based system. Unix means Unix or Linux. Okay? Anyone use this command? Okay, good. Good amount of people. Yeah. There's an example. I want to show you. I use the dot command in one of my server. You can see that. There's always, for every process, there's a process ID. Okay? And there is a CPU percentage. How much CPU is getting used by that process? And there is a command and there is a user. So from there you can see what exact command or what exact programming overloaded the CPU. In a worst case scenario, this percentage goes to 100%, 120%, 140%. Okay? Okay, so yeah, you know that, okay, that is causing the CPU overload. But what is causing it? There are two utility, I would say, LSOF and mode status. I have used to diagnose this. LSOF is a command line. This is a command line utility, list of open file utility. And it will tell you, okay, this process is getting used by this command or this program. And mode status. Mode status is a Apache module. It's not a command line utility, it's a Apache module which you need to install. You can diagnose the problem using this module also. I'll tell you how. Okay, LSOF command. In LSOF command, you can use minus P for process ID and you know how to get a process ID. Right? There is a PID. Okay? So, with minus P command, minus P attribute, you can use the process ID and minus C. With minus C attribute, you can use the actual command. For example, if Apache is causing the problem, you can use HTTPD. If MySQL is causing the CPU overload, then use MySQL. Then it will help you to identify what other files are getting used by that command. Okay, there is another thing which I mentioned, mode status. Mode status is a mode status is what? A passive mode. Mode status is a passive mode, and when you install the mode status, you will get the server underscore status, this area for your diagnosis. And this is the example I took from Apache report, and you can see that for every HTTP request, GET request, there you can find the process ID from here. Okay? So you know the process ID from top, which is calling the overload, and from here, okay, this process ID getting this request. Then you can get, okay, this request is calling you. Then you can identify, you can diagnose the code in that particular area. So you can find out, okay, this area is causing you the problem, I need to fix this area. Okay, so that might be the script which is sending this timing also. Okay, so this is how we get this CPU overload problem. And there is another thing you can do which can help you to identify the problem is the Apache access log. Okay, in Apache access log, this is one of the examples from those attack. You can see this is a what you call the URL, a referral URL. This is the post request and it is going to this admin Ajax. Okay, so you at least know that there is an Ajax request which is getting exploited by the spammer or hacker. So you need to identify from there. Okay, the problem. At least you know where is the problem. Okay, I'll tell you what happened in my case. There was a theme which we bought from the theme forest and used one of the sites, and it has the this thing with your email address sent to friend form, and this was easily exploited by the spammer, because you can post the form email address, you can post the true email address, and there was a message. And there was no real validation like cross-site request, cross-site and all those things. So it was easily exploitable. And then that's the code behind it. I've already informed the person who made the theme also about this exploit. So yeah, I can show it here also. So this kind of code can be the problem. Next year, if you use such kind of font, you have some sort of validation also here, so that it cannot be exploited. Okay? Okay, now another problem, which is pretty common, I guess, and happens to most of the people, that there is all the brute force attack, either from your server, if the spammer gets the control, or from your server or towards your WordPress website. Right? How many of you are getting, like, who are using IT security plugins? Okay, many of you. That's good. Are you getting like, okay, this IP is blocked because of a lot of attempts? How many of you are getting those kind of things? Okay, many of you. So that means there is a brute force attack to your website from the third party. The party, the website which is taken control by the spammer, okay? So it can be the two cases. Either your server is sending the brute force attack, or you are getting it. So let's identify this. Okay, so what's the way? So there is only a good way in a common line to get all that TCP traffic. And TCP traffic, TCP packets also. TCP packets, so TCP down is the command line utility which can help you a lot. It can give you the details of incoming HTTP request and outgoing HTTP request as well. Okay, let's see example. TCP down, okay, this is the example. And then I can show you great host. Why did I did this great host? Because the host in every HTTP request, there is a host field, right? In the host field, you know that to which host this HTTP request is directed. So this is the TCP dump command, and from the packet, I'm getting the details about the host, and I'm getting the first chain line and another chain line from that request. So let's say this is the one of the HTTP request, www.proshore.ll. It's just two hours in our server. So it means this HTTP request towards our website. So from this host field, you can identify that whether the request is to your server or from your server. If there is a website at xyz.com.io, let's say. If that comes in this host field, then you can easily identify .com.io, you are not hosting it. Then you can easily say, okay, there is a brute force attack from my server, right? So this host field can give you the idea about the brute force attack is to your server or from your server. Okay, there is another example which I used to know. Okay, there is an attack on wplogin.php. Most of the time, this spammer script, what it does, it attacks wplogin.php with the admin username. I think everybody knows that. So, first, in every security, in a presentation, you can say that don't use the username admin, okay? So that's the bottom line. Don't use the username admin, because every spamming script which I've seen so far use the admin as username and some graphics as random password and use the brute force attack. Okay, these are the definition, the example of this command line. Minus A means print all the packets, and minus I means interface. And here, this is ETH0 because all the Linux kernel after 2.2 use the ETH0 as an interface. And minus S maps dot length, which I want to use only 1500 bytes of the TCP packet. Okay? I don't want to have a large paragraph. So that's about it. And then you know there's a header. Now you need to know the PID because you need to know the process ID. Without getting the process ID, you cannot diagnose further. So what you need to do now is use the next step command. Anybody use this command? Okay. The next step minus A, I mean minus P. Minus P is a parameter which will give you the process ID, the PID. Let's say I'm using this command in my server, and you can see there is a connection, SSH connection, which obviously I was doing at the moment. There is an IAP connection, and you can see for every network system there is a process ID. And if you have the process ID, then what do you need to do? I told you before. Okay, this is the details of the parameter. Minus A, switch by the address parameter. So here is INET. And minus P. Minus P means I told you before, the process ID. Now you have the process ID. And I told you before, those two techniques. LSOF, use LSOF to know the, what are the open files from that. That's all. And then mode status. Mode status also. I think I showed you in the previous presentation that a mode status will give you the HTTP request with the process ID. Okay, so from here you can see okay, there's a network connection and you can diagnose those connections. Okay. That's about it. That's how I diagnose the problem. And if you have any questions, let's go ahead. Okay, thank you everyone.